Wondering what all the buzz is about when it comes to augmented reality and virtual reality? Well, stay tuned to find out more. Welcome to Build, brought to you by Pivotal Tracker. I'm your host, Purnima Vijay Shankar. In each episode of Build, innovators and I debunk a number of myths and misconceptions related to building products, companies, and your career in tech. You've probably heard that augmented reality and virtual reality are the wave of the future, and maybe you're reluctant to join all the buzz. Well, I don't blame you. In today's episode, we're going to debunk a number of myths and misconceptions related to augmented reality and virtual reality. And then in the future episode, we're going to talk about some of its applications. And to help us out, I've invited Rose Haft, who is the CEO and founder of Luminora. Thanks for joining us today, Rose.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, so why don't we just get started by introducing to our audience, in case they're not familiar, what exactly is the difference between augmented reality, AR, and virtual reality, VR?
Absolutely. Yeah, so augmented reality and virtual reality are a way to have a computer interface that's very close to the eye that allows for there to be a different way to interact with the computer than what you're used to today. So augmented reality makes it possible to see what's happening in the real world that everyone else can see with a little bit of image overlay that will help to display text or data. And if you've heard of Magic Leap, it'll also help to display holograms and things that look very lifelike. The difference between augmented and virtual reality is that in virtual reality, you have your own environment and you're not able to access any of the exterior world. So you're completely immersed inside of that environment. So it makes it a little bit more difficult to see what's happening elsewhere, but there are a lot of really useful applications for being fully immersed and reasons why people really enjoy using it.
So maybe you can tell us what got you interested in augmented and virtual reality, and then we can talk about why you decided to start your company.
I got interested in augmented and virtual reality in high school. I knew I wanted to be an engineer, and I had an opportunity to work as an intern at one of the local prototyping facilities. And at that facility, we were working on building advanced headsets for the military. I really had a chance to see how having a hands-free tool that could be worn can really do anything from help to save lives, as well as help to communicate silently between people. I thought it was really interesting, a different way of interacting in technology than had ever been there before.
So what inspired you to start your company, Luminora?
Yeah, so after working at several companies, including working at Meta, helping to design the Meta 2, I realized that there were a lot of logistical and engineering reasons why people weren't able to build the headsets that I felt like were ideal, and also why those reasons are also part of the reasons why people don't want to adopt them. And so I was studying at Stanford a little bit of biomedical engineering and how to use sensors like you would in surgery, and I thought it'd be great to incorporate them into a headset. And again, there are logistical reasons to doing that. And so after I found a partner company that could help solve one of the major problems in the area, and with my unique background in design, knowing how to design things differently, it was a really great match to build something that is more advanced, more capable, and people actually want to wear it and use it.
Yeah. Do you mind sharing the application of what you're working on?
Yeah. So right now, we're kind of fitting into the maintenance, repair, and operations space. There are over 200 companies internationally that are using it to do things like supply chain management. Companies like BMW who build cars find it useful to make sure they're choosing the right parts and putting them together in the right way and making sure that their quality process, you don't have to go back and double check work, you're doing it right in the first time.
Got it. So it's really a training platform.
Yep.
For people.
So we're adding in extra features, and we're doing some fun and cutting edge things that will help to even more improve improve those industries, especially like training. So in order for people to learn skills and trade crafts, and majority of the Americans who hold the same job title need to go to school to learn these things and how to work on specific machines and machine types. And so we'll be integrating a real-time training system where you can learn a new skill or craft in real time. You don't need to have the several years of school. So we'll be able to adopt robots faster and self-driving cars and those sort of things.
Very nice. So you mentioned early on that there's been a lot of reluctance to adopting this new technology, AR and VR. Why is that?
There's a lot of reluctance for a variety of reasons. People haven't found that they're stylish enough or cool enough, and also really haven't found the benefits. They've really only seen the detriments and pullbacks as far as feeling like their security is being threatened or their privacy would be threatened because of the ability to record and take in information. So I think the use cases are just now starting to be developed. One of my favorites is there's a 3D graphing app, and so you can use a calculus. And I know we're doing some fun and cutting edge things that really will help the average everyday person meet typical goals and those sort of things. And it'll make it better and easier to adopt once those use cases are there.
Yeah, and we'll hold that thought. We're going to dive into those use cases in the next episode. So there's also a lot of myths being propagated right now. And I think one of them, because of the lack of adoption, people just are saying that AR VR is dead and there's not much going on. Is that true? Are people not building these headsets anymore? Are they no longer investing in the technology infrastructure?
Yeah, that's absolutely not true whatsoever.
Okay. Yeah,
there's still a lot of investing to try to find the right solutions and the right designs, and so people can actually wear them and adopt them. I know companies like mine have tried to stay as much out of the media as possible because people have spent billions of dollars trying to find the right solution, and as soon as you put something out there, people feel like they can help themselves. So working on companies like mine who are working on very proprietary things, we're making sure that they're developing and building strength. And so we're doing a lot of things in the background that can't be seen quite yet. And eventually we'll come to mainstream once we really feel like we'll be able to offer something that people really want.
So are there any other myths that are being propagated aside from the one around it being dead?
Yeah, so people think they're ugly.
Right.
The glass hole is like the standard term that's used. We're building something that will be a lot more sleek and stylish and have a lot more options in order to wear it and have it look different. And I think the use cases that we're developing will be cool enough and necessary enough that people will want to adopt it anyways.
So yeah, you're seeing a lot of friction just in terms of the adoption because of change of behavior, because people don't see this as prevalent. So that makes sense. So there's already a number of big players in the market today. You know, Facebook has Oculus, Google, like you mentioned, used to have Google Glass. So what exactly is the difference between some of these big players and maybe what you're building and what you see other people building?
The main differences between each of the companies are the form factor and the technology that's being used to develop them. There are several different optical technologies that are used, and those really make a big difference in what a headset looks like. Most of the virtual reality headsets have a screen, like your cell phone, that's in front of the eyes, and there are lenses that help you to see an image clearly, and that's one type of technology. Companies like Google have something called a beam splitter inside the Google Glass. And while it's a smaller form factor, it has limited capabilities. Companies like Vuzix have something called a waveguide that has limitations around it as far as the brightness of the image and the amount of the screen that's able to be filled. And that might be a very technical explanation, but
that's okay. We have very technical.
Well, this is, I'm hoping to share relevant information. And so the biggest difference between each of the systems is the way the computer image is generated so somebody can see it. And those are really the big three ones that you see right now. Meta has a direct reflection. I helped to come up with that design. I built a Meta hired me because I had built a prototype, and they thought my prototype was cool, and they hired me on to help with that.
Yeah, that's awesome. So when our audience out there is trying to evaluate between fact and fiction when it comes down to augmented reality and virtual reality, what would you say to kind of arm them?
Yeah, so In order to help understand the difference between fact and fiction in the augmented and virtual reality environment, a lot of companies are going out and giving a lot of information and showing pictures and those sort of things without actually having a product. Mm-hmm. So it's really important to look at how close is whatever is seen mm-hmm. actually able to go out and be used in the world. And also companies that have a lot of hype, where they are getting the most press and it sure. seems the most exciting, aren't necessarily the ones who are building the most useful tools. So I think it's kind of, companies can be like people. And so if they're kind of showing off a whole lot, but not really putting anything behind mm-hmm. Behind the game, then there's probably a problem with it. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, encourage your audience, everyone out there, to really learn the science behind what's happening. And part of the reason why we've been able to do things differently at Luminara is because I knew the science mm-hmm. and I was able to go through and do things differently because I knew the limitations of the methods trying to be implemented. So science and also fact check and double check if something's actually ready or usable or wearable. And companies like Facebook who have a 5-year plan in order mm-hmm. to build something, and they've talked about that at F8 and those sort of things, they haven't necessarily released anything publicly to mm-hmm. show what they're working on. And those are the companies that are more genuinely putting an effort into creating something useful before they go out and get credit for something they've not yet done.
Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense. Well, thank you so much, Rose. This has been really eye-opening for us. So I appreciate you coming on the show and sharing.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Rose and I want to know, do you have any questions related to augmented reality and virtual reality? Let us know what they are in the comments below. And that's it for today's episode of Build. Be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel to receive the next episode, where we'll do a deeper dive into talking about some of the applications of augmented and virtual reality. Ciao for now!
This episode of Build is brought to you by our main sponsor, Pivotal Tracker. We'd also like to thank our Platinum Patreon patrons, Corgi Bites, The Developer Show, D. Gill, and Jamie Hand. Finally, thanks to the following new patrons, Madhu Loganathan and Sita Anamurgu. If you've enjoyed watching Build, please consider becoming a patron and contributing on Patreon at www.patreon.com/build. You can pledge $5 a month or more, and your pledges will go towards helping us produce and promote the show. In exchange, you'll receive perks like being mentioned in the credits and digital copies of our latest ebooks. Platinum patrons will receive exclusive perks like monthly online group coaching, where I provide more hands-on coaching and a number of topics related to entrepreneurship and leadership. To find out more and contribute, please visit www.patreon.com/build.